Good. Well, and that, now, have a seat for our second lecture today. That's by Matthias, and the title is The Measurement Problem. Thank you, Rudy, for this introduction, and welcome everybody again. Today I will speak about the measurement problem. The measurement problem is perhaps the most fundamental problem in quantum mechanics, and it is a problem from which a lot of other questions and paradoxes derive. The paradox is not of the surprising type, more of the actually logically predictive type. So my outline for now is first to explain what the measurement problem is, to kind of grasp it more precisely, then to say that Schrödinger's cat is actually an instance, illustration of that measurement problem, to draw conclusions at this point, and point towards possible solutions of this problem, which will set the stage for later talks in this lecture series. They all of these will center around taking different conclusions from the measurement problem, but all of them were solved. And then I've also discussed some objections to that there is a measurement problem and respond to them. And finally, if we still have time, I will also explain a different but very related paradox, namely that of Brinkmann's friend, which you could say is more or less the same, but with some twist on the measurement problem. But that only if you have time. So let's start at the beginning. What is the measurement problem? And the measurement problem will consist that in the following that, namely, we have a bunch of assumptions, and we will see that they are contradictory. What are these assumptions? Well, first, and I mean, I even put this as an assumption here, but I mean, I guess it's almost going without saying, maybe that we say that quantum mechanics can be applied to every isolated, at least physical system. Then the next one is that the wave function is a complete description of a physical system. Then, in each run of the experiment, there is a unique outcome. And finally, that the evolution of Schrödinger's, the evolution of the wave function, at least of an isolated system, is given by Schrödinger's equation. All right, so these are the assumptions. Bear them in mind, they will come up again. But now let's continue to the situation I want to consider. We consider a measurement process schematically as follows. We have a system, I mean, let's say like an atom. I mean, it's just a picture for an atom. You don't have to take this too literally. But we have to take definitely, you don't really know directly how that looks like. But you have to take literally is a measurement device. Now, this is something we have access to, you can definitely see. And this measurement device has several different pointer positions. At the beginning, it says it's in the ready state, and then it can display different outcomes according to what kind of results it finds for our system. Realistically, this will also be a discrete number of results in here, 1 to 8. Okay. Now we create a wave function model for the situation. The object, so this atom here, will have an initial wave function psi 0, and the apparatus, which we also measure as a quantum mechanical system, the wave function phi 0. So initially, the wave function of the entire system is just a tensor product, psi 0, tensor phi 0. Now we do this experiment with a discrete number of outcomes, alpha 1 to alpha n, for which we have an orthonormal basis of object states, psi 1 to psi n, and apparatus states, phi 1 to phi n. These apparatus states, they also have the additional property that in configuration space, their supports are disjoint, so they will be orthogonal, but moreover, they will be actually macroscopically disjoint, so kind of disjoint by a fair amount. So you can really kind of distinguish with your eye when you see something, a configuration in that support and that support, you can just tell the difference very easily. For example, this measurement device displaying 1 or 2. Yeah, not something like really great kind of tiny difference of the pointer, really some kind of substantial one. All right. So now Schrödinger's equation, if you let it go for this joint system or apparatus and atom, will do the following. It will map the wave function, which is this initial tensor product, to an entangled state at time t1. This entangled state consists of phi alpha tensor epsilon. So we get a superposition here. Now, if we try to see what would actually happen from this wave function evolution, we would get the following picture. We would get that, well, we have this state that represents, we found the atom in a certain state, and the apparatus pointing to its respective outcome, plus the next one, and so on. Now, why perhaps for the atom this could be like, kind of, we don't really know what the atom does, right? We don't like, see it with our eye. But now this seems really kind of problematic that we could easily see simply that our apparatus really has what we see at one state, but this superposition would suggest that we have a superposition of many different ones, which are all disjoint. So this leads us to a superposition of states corresponding to different outcomes, not a random single definite outcome as one observes. And that discrepancy is called the measurement problem. All right. So now, what does it have to do with Schrödinger's cat? Right. It is quite similar. The situation you have for Schrödinger's cat is the following. I read it off how Schrödinger wrote it. He described this himself. One can even set up quite ridiculous cases. A cat is penned up in a steel chamber along with the following diabolical device, which must be secured against direct interference by the cat. In a Geiger counter, there's a tiny bit of radioactive substance, so small that perhaps in the course of an hour, one of the atoms decays, but also, with equal probability, perhaps none. If it happens, the counter tube discharges and through a relay releases a hammer, which shatters a small flask of hydrocyanic acid. If one has left this entire system to itself for an hour, one would say that the cat still lives, if meanwhile no atom has decayed. The first atomic decay would have poisoned it. The psi function of the entire system would express this by having in it the living and the dead cat, pardon the expression, mixed or smeared out in equal parts. It is typical of these cases that an indeterminacy originally restricted to the atomic domain becomes transformed into macroscopic indeterminacy, which can then be resolved by direct observation. That prevents us from so naively accepting as valid a blurred model for representing reality. In itself, it would not embody anything unclear or contradictory. There is a difference between a shaky or out-of-focus photograph and a snapshot of clouds and fog banks. So what in Schrödinger's cat we have is that essentially the cat is our measurement device that displays in the end in a macroscopic way whether or not the atom will have decayed. It is essentially the pointer of the measurement device. And so this is an instance, Schrödinger's cat is an instance of the measurement problem. We could see that more formally as follows. As psi of t is zero, we have a wave function of the atom in a zero state, a wave function of this Geiger counter in the ready state, and a wave function of the cat also in the ready state. That evolves then by the Schrödinger evolution into a superposition of, I hope I got the factors right, an atom which is decayed, a wave function of the atom which is decayed, wave function of the counter which triggers and wave function of the cat, which is dead. And dead means like it has support in the kind of dead part of the configuration space. And plus three equal parts, a wave function of the atom which is not decayed, a counter which is still ready, and a cat which is still alive. So you get the same situation before. And to emphasize again, what Schrödinger's point was also that perhaps for the atom, it could be in a superposition. We really don't really know what atoms are like. We have no direct access to them. But certainly for the cat, it could not. Simply that contradicts our observation. So what are the conclusions? Well, at least one of our assumptions must be wrong. I repeat them again. Like zero quantum mechanics can be applied to every isolated physical system. Probably that we don't really want to deny. First, the wave function is a complete description of a physical system. The second, in each run of the experiment, there's a unique outcome. And third, the evolution of the wave function of an isolated system is given by Schrödinger's equation. So one of them has to go, and the possible resolutions of the measurement problem, which you will see in detail in the following talks, negate one or more of these assumptions. Negating the first assumption, completeness, is the way that Bohmian mechanics chooses. It adds particles in addition to the wave function, which have actual ground lines guided by the wave function, in a certain wave, which we will hear about soon. Then, negating the second assumption, unique outcomes, leads to the many-world interpretation. You could, perhaps in a simplified way, say that every possible outcome actually occurs, but in a different world. And then, negating three, the correctness of Schrödinger's equation, and in fact also A, leads to objective collapse theories. What you will do there is to modify Schrödinger's equation and incorporate a stochastic term in it, which objectively makes the wave function collapse randomly. But not kind of subjectively, we will discuss this collapse also in a minute, but objectively. And in addition, also this theory adds a primitive ontology, something the world consists of, let's say a meta density, for example. Yeah, so that would also negate the completeness of the wave function in a sense. All right, you'll hear more about these resolutions later. So now we will discuss the different kind of angles on the measurement problem further. I would like to discuss briefly the way orthodox quantum mechanics choose at this point. Orthodox quantum mechanics, of course, also has to explain somehow, or not explain, but somehow incorporate that you will have just one definite outcome after a measurement. And what orthodox quantum mechanics does is take the collapse possible. And it was a paraphrase that is as follows. If one observes the result alpha in the measurement of an observable A at time t, the quantum states of the system afterwards jumps to the respective eigenstate psi alpha. Well, what we do here is we produce a definite outcome by force. We will just cancel by ourselves one term in the wave function that was there before is not there in the next moment. But it does produce a definite outcome then if we use that. It does override then Schrödinger's equation. It negates the correctness of Schrödinger's equation, since you allow yourself to do something different. Yes?
Could you maybe say that, so to me it seems you could also say that somehow you could say that an agnostic postulate that says, okay, any one of these solutions could be true. Because, I mean, you could also say for some reason we have the collapse. It doesn't give a description why the collapse happened. So you could argue that under the collapse postulate, you could, as an underlying explanation, either one of the three could be fitted under the collapse postulate.
Yeah, that's correct, because in a sense, all of these interpretations of quantum mechanics, at least some of them, are certainly not the most interpretation, there would be no, not even an effective collapse, if I understand. But I mean, in certainly Bowman mechanics, you have some kind of effective collapse that you can explain for wave function of subsystems, while the wave function of a whole system never collapses. And then GW theory will just have objective collapse. I'm just discussing how quantum mechanics does it. I mean, you think it's still correct.
Okay, but
so you
don't
say
don't necessarily to override the Schrodinger equation. But just, I think the collapse process is compatible with any of the systems.
No, I think it does override the Schrodinger equation.
Okay.
No? I mean, so how could you deny that? One instance you have, I mean, it's just you don't, if you let Schrodinger's equation go, it you remain with this superposition.
Yeah, but many words also, I mean, many words you say don't override the Schrodinger equation, and quantum mechanics also does not override the Schrodinger equation. And they can also be seen as explanations for the collapse postulate, that's what I mean. So
yes, but it comes out in a somewhat different way. So the collapse postulate is not so absolute anymore, it comes out effectively. But I guess the appropriate point to really discuss this further is when we look at these theories. And then, and apparently, I think, in my opinion, this is one of the most problematic points, is to use the collapse postulate. You, in this way, at least, as I phrase it, you use this phrase, if one observes. So that means you're postulating, essentially, that there are some parts of the system which are classical. They don't obey quantum mechanics, like observers or measurement devices. And there are parts of the system which do behave quantum mechanically, and like the atom before, or perhaps even the cat. This distinction is quite arbitrary. And so, I mean, of course, since we believe that everything consists actually of atoms, if you use this distinction, it also means not giving reductionism. But please, in English.
Yeah. Why can't you raise reductionism?
Can you write that?
Contradicts reductions. I don't understand.
Ah, yeah. So we believe that everything consists of atoms, and then if everything consists of the same kind of thing, you should use the same kind of mathematics to describe it. But we're not if you're using a distinction between classical things and quantum objects. Yeah, so it's a kind of dangerous thing. You somehow give up to extend, if you really take that seriously, which probably you don't. If you take that seriously, you give up explaining physics in a complete way. That seems quite contradictory to use such a possible. All right, but I mean, since you have started already to question certain things, let me come. Ah, okay. So it's even one point more. It's like. It negates also the collapse postulate. Negates also the universal applicability of QM because observers do not obey quantum mechanics. My mechanics were part of the previous one. I also want to emphasize that. And also negates one that the wave function is a complete description. Namely, if you just have wave functions, then you would not have observers, you would not have any distinction, you allow yourself to have something more. Some more classical variables or classical observers and quantum systems. So this postulate leads to many problems and potential inconsistencies. One can do much better, which you will hear in the following talk. So only three resolutions that I mentioned, they won't have such, at least not such inconsistencies. Okay, but now let me come really to excuses and responses to them. So many people deny that there's a measurement problem, and we have collected some objections. I mean, this may seem like a kind of random list, of course, we can discuss later as well. Excuse one, maybe we really see superpositions of a dead and alive cat once technology progresses. Well, but we do not now, and at least this fact that we do not know has to be explained. Excuse two, nobody can in fact solve the Schrödinger equation for a realistic number 10 to the 23 of particles. Response? Well, that's correct. But for the argument, it's not necessary to really solve the Schrödinger equation, it's enough to know what qualitatively happens. Linearity will definitely lead to a superposition of macroscopically different states. Excuse number three, consciousness solves the measurement problem. I mean, as I define the measurement problem, that's not correct. No, it does not. Maybe that would amount to negating zero, the universal applicability of quantum mechanics, and also the completeness, because consciousness then would not obey quantum mechanics. And if it did, it would still lead to the same kind of problem. So everyone who takes such a view, I have a challenge for you. Set up a consistent theory of consciousness first, and then we can talk. Right? As far as I know, no one is really done. Excuse.
Actually, there's a group in California, QGR. They are actually trying working on this thing.
Okay, so I mean, it would be very interesting to discuss about that.
Yeah.
Excuse number four. Systems are never really isolated. The response. One can always take into account more, so eventually, hopefully, a system either becomes isolated, yeah, or it becomes the whole universe, which is then by definition isolated. And if you deny yourself either possibility that you don't admit that there would be isolated systems, where it's fine to just stop modeling more by quantum mechanics, if you deny that, and also deny that the whole universe could put in order by a wave function, well, then you have no hope describing, where what hope do you have describing describing the physics by a quantum mechanical theory? Then, excuse number five, what if the initial wave function is not a product, minus for some perhaps idealization that we made? And the response is, that's actually not very important. Just that one can perform a measurement on every initial psi. So the more important for the measurement problem is that we have this eventual superposition of different, macroscopically different states. Excuse number six. The collapse of the wave function is just like the collapse of a probability distribution. When one obtains more information, say that the actual configuration of the system is in a certain set, then one has to update the probability distribution rho t according to rho at the next instance of time after t goes to the indicator function of that set where you found it times rho before that time. The answer, this is indeed a striking parallel. However, if the wave function is supposed to be complete, then there will never be any new information external to the wave function which we can update on. This thought, the previous thought, actually refers to the problematic observer system split, where you already allowed yourself someone, observer, which doesn't obey the same thing, can obtain new information. But that's what we were more starting more basic than that. We didn't allow ourselves any such distinction, which also would be problematic. Alright. Excuse number seven. As used to be a common excuse, so it's quite important to discuss that in detail. Decoherence solved the measurement problem. So, well, first, what does decoherence mean? I will discuss actually kind of two things which are more or less the same. First one is very clear that it doesn't solve, and the second one, it is a little bit harder to see at first, but I will also explain what happens then. So first, decoherence means that we have this transition in that form where the supports of phi alpha and phi beta are so two different environment states, again this should be still in alpha, are macroscopically disjoint in configuration space. And as a consequence of this macroscopic disjointness, they can, for all practical purposes, never be brought to interfere anymore. That this is a very typical process would happen for systems with many degrees of freedom. Well, now we have seen that this exactly leads to the paradox of Schrödinger's cat. Exactly, this microscopic disjointness of the support even makes things more problematic, not less. You will have, of course, like a wave function of the let's say of the dead cat and of the live cat, which don't interfere anymore in any way, but still both there. So we don't get this problem solved that we have just one of them. Okay, so that's the first way of describing acoustic coherence. There's also another way, decoherence in the reduced density matrix formulas. There it's perhaps a bit harder to see what happens. So let's discuss that also. So a decoherent system, with a system part X and an environment part E, we have that the reduced density matrix, rho reduced, given by the trace over the environment of some quantum state, becomes approximately diagonal, while still the system environment state is entangled. So that's just a fact that will happen in decoherent situations. And now the thing is that this state has the same mathematical form as a statistical density matrix, which describes a situation where one randomly prepares the wave function S in one of the states alpha with probabilities CA. However, and now that's the response to the objection, the meaning of these two objects is not the same. In the reduced density matrix case, the system has no own state, only the joint entangled state together with the environment. To make this clear that one talks about such a situation, one refers first to a diagonal rho reduced as an improper mixture. So from the pure mathematical form, we don't know which situation is described. But I mean, you knew that you start with a reduced density matrix and that your system didn't actually have a state in its own. So this mere coincidence of the same mathematical expression doesn't mean anything.
Excuse me, could you explain a little bit more about this improper mixture and improper mixture? Because as Shorty mentioned, there's no way, physical way to distinguish them.
I think the physical situation is very distinct in these two cases. So, and at first you would have simply prepared one state for system and environment.
Yeah.
And the system, you can form the reduced density matrix, that's what you get. In the other case, you will randomly prepare the system in different states with certain probabilities. So it's a completely different physical thing. It just does not reflect in the mathematical forms of these density matrices. But of course, also even the formulas used to compute these density matrices are different. So both the physical situation is different, and the mathematical situation where you derive that object from as well. Okay, how is time working now?
You have lots of time.
Okay, that's good. I mean, actually don't need that much time anymore, but then we can also discuss weakness frame. Let's come to weakness frame. Consider the following situation. Weakness friend F is observing Schrödinger's cat C. Weakness later checks that the friend has found the cat dead or alive. And you can add, of course, the atom also, if you want. So the quantum description of this is if we tried to model this whole system as quantum mechanical, as we should if you want to universally apply quantum mechanics, we will obtain the following superposition in the end, after letting Schrödinger evolution go. So we will have a dead cat, a state for a dead cat, tensor a stage for Wigner's friend who like says, oh, well, I found it dead. And also Wigner, who found the friend sad about the death of the cat. And plus, cat is alive, friend is happy, and Wigner also happy. Okay, so again, you see this leads to another instantiation of the measurement problem, as we have a microscopic superposition here. So it is, in some sense, you could say Wigner's friend is just the same as the measurement problem. But there's a little twist on it, and we can discuss that. Maybe this twist comes from if you allow yourself to use the call-outs possum, then what we'll see is there is some problematic features about the call-outs possum. So if you try to use this call-outs possum, then there will be some added difficulties. First, one part of the system, presumably the friend or Wigner, because these are persons and you kind of feel that persons perhaps can call up the wave function, is not modeled by a wave function. But that's already problematic because we allow ourselves here to make a distinction between quantum, if what obeys the rules of quantum mechanics or does not. Then also second, we will obtain a lot of different possible wave functions depending on which part of the system we model as quantum mechanical or not. A, so you can have a wave function for the cat and for the friend to be kind of observed by Wigner later. Yeah, so that would mean we will get in the end a dead cat and a sad friend plus a live cat tensor happy friend. And Wigner will later kind of check on which one you got and use the call-outs postulate. So that perhaps you would do by like seeing Wigner as kind of the last person who ever does a call-out. But of course, like, well, I mean, who will do it? So I mean, you could also take a different wave function and you just say, well, the friend will later see about the situation. So then you would have also such a superposition, but now with the state for Wigner instead of the friend. Or you could even allow yourself to let the cat check whether the cat just realizes in the end, I'm dead and everyone is sad, or I'm alive and everyone's happy. So the cat can also look on the other people as well. So I mean, if you allow yourself to have an observer, it's not clear anymore that what the kind of wave function would be and who would collapse it. So then a lot of questions arise. Is one of these psi's the right one, or are several possible? And if several are possible, how are they related? I mean, if several are possible, you should have some kind of rules how to translate them so no consistency arises. But that's up to the person who kind of uses these postulates to give you such a kind of, to demonstrate to you that it's not inconsistent. So it's a kind of problem for such a person. And of course, related to these wave functions is the question, who can collapse a wave function? It's already kind of problematic. Can the cat do it? Can a friend do it? Can Wigner do it? Can one of them do it? Can all of them do it? Can if you go smaller and smaller, can a mouse collapse the wave function? Can a amoeba collapse the wave function? Can a nucleus of a cell collapse the wave function? Can a large molecule collapse the wave function? Can an atom collapse the wave function? If you try to be a reactionist about it, you're not going to be happy. It's not going to like give you any sharp split when you can collapse anything.
I don't want to take the discussion, push it forward. So, are you also talking about solutions to this, or
to the measurement problem?
Yes, no, to the behavior of
friends. Well, if you solve the measurement problem, you solve just
no. Same. I don't solve the measurement problem. I want to say, I mean, this is also an, I would say, an unsympathetic reading as the first one of the collapse postulate, because I mean. I'm trying to be impartial to interpretations, but I just want to play advocate diabolique here. So I mean,
so
you could just say that, I mean, that anyone has an informational interpretation of quantum mechanics. Yeah, you would say anyone can collapse the wave function who can use the formalism to describe her probability distribution.
That sounds very unsure. So I mean, who can use the formalism? Can a mouse use the formalism?
No, I mean it is. I think the information embraces the split, but it's not a physical dualism like we had in Cartesian times, but it's, the split is like you have a plane of physical description of the world, and you have, in Kantian terms, transcendental plane where you describe how the plane on which you apply the quantum mechanics to describe your subjective or your objective probability distribution. But I mean, that's, and then you could say that anyone who can use this formalism can collapse his wave function. But I mean, the solution that these people give to being his friend is that obviously that when they communicate their solutions to each other, they interact physically. And then obviously, then you have one clear. So that's how people resolve the contradiction.
So I'm not sure whether that resolves the contradiction. I mean, I think we would have to specify that kind of this approach more universally to really see it. But there's a comment?
Yeah. Yeah, can I add a brief comment to this? I think it's relevant here that one can take two different perspectives. One perspective is, suppose you want to compute what the possible results will be, and compute what the probabilities will be of these results. Okay, then kind of all different ways of doing the computation or looking at it or all different interpretations, they arrive at the same result. The outcomes are dead, sad, sad, or alive, happy, happy, and both have probability 1/2. Now here's a different question you can ask, or a different perspective you can take. That's the question, what is actually happening in reality? And kind of, it makes a difference whether you're asking the one question or the other. For example, for the collapse of the wave function, maybe it doesn't matter for actually deriving the prediction when you collapse or how you collapse the wave function, but when you're asking the question what happens in reality, it does make a difference. So
to some extent, I think that this is the point I want to make, that the standard interpretation and the sympathetic reading does not say it forbids to ask the question what happens in reality, but you could also read it, the collapse postulate, as this is how you predict the result, but as diagnostic what happens to reality. And then it leaves you open, you could say, make space.
But then you find you just accept that there is a problem. You don't attempt to resolve it. I mean, just show that there would be a problem. And also, you said, mentioned information. Information seems to be a kind of very problematic notion in this situation. Maybe it also seems to make this cut between someone who has the information and something you have the information about. And then if you say there is something to have, you have information about, you should be kind of saying what is it that you have information about. I'm introducing something else, you were not speaking about it at first. So I mean, all these questions need to be discussed if you then want to discuss about information. I'm not sure which theory in particular I have in mind, but I just want to make clear what kind of question or potential problems run into here. I'm not saying that it can't be resolved. When you will see that they can be resolved in many different ways, and perhaps you have also such a very different way in mind. But what I'm saying is that as it stands, there are a lot of questions and problems, and they're not really answered by the normal form.
Okay.
No?
Okay, but it's not. Okay, my problem is only the contradiction, but there are many problems, but the formalism still is not contradictory in itself, as long as it doesn't say I'm about reality. So this is the point. If the standard formalism does not necessarily claim that he wants to describe,
but it's not reality. How is it relevant to us?
I mean, again, I'm playing advocate here. I'm maybe you could say it's not supposed to say what reality is, but to describe, to give us quantitative descriptions of the world.
Yeah, but it doesn't, apparently it doesn't even do a just basic thing, maybe, like to see whether a definite outcome happens or it does not happen. Yeah?
Just to answer, there are paradoxes that are paradoxes only for certain views of reality, certain views of science, but you have to resolve them for them because you have to accept that some people have this view.
Sure. But I think this is not just a logical instance, it's really an instance where there's an objective problem, but maybe I specify what kind of things are a contradiction. And so we saw that like these statements have some contradiction in them. It's not just that you have a certain view, you have a problem.
Yes, if you don't believe there is a reality at all, this is not
No, the point is, if you don't know the reason, the mechanism is on the contrary, then there is a problem. That was pushing it. That's pretty precise. You have to negate one of these aspects that I wrote down. Otherwise, you run into the problem, whatever interpretation you have.
When it comes to anti-realist interpretations, doesn't the PDR theorem now rule out most of the anti-realist interpretations?
It certainly rules out some, I'm not sure about all. Probably not.
But like, I feel like this is more of a priori discussion on scientific realism versus scientific anti-realism than basically looking at quantum mechanics as anti-realist or realist.
What is more realist or anti-realist?
The points that he was making,
But also PBR, there are also people who are arguing that, for example, PBR overlooks certain aspects and doesn't treat the measurement device quantum mechanically. So there's one master student in the, I forgot his name, but he also wrote a paper about it from Munich, from the philosophy of Munich, that, for example, quantum mechanics solves is completely compatible with PBR. And in their argument, they don't treat the measurement system quantum mechanically. So there are many realists, also quantum mechanics, many realist interpretations which are really compatible with each other.
Okay, so I was like soon leading over to the discussion session anyway, but let me finish these few slides at a second. And maybe the most interesting question for Rima's kind of actually the question, if you say that collapse occurs, it occurs somewhat objectively, then when does it occur? So does it occur when the cat dies and lives, or lives? Or does it occur when the friend gets to know that, or when Wigner gets to know that the friend would be known? But it's kind of a paradox, a potential, or at least a potential paradox that person and location of kind of people, observers can collapse the wave function runs into. Because there are several instances where you could do that. And then also you would think that at least the friend and Wigner should be treated on the same footing, but then depending on who did what, then you would change the earlier or later collapse of the wave function. It's a kind of paradox. So again you get all kinds of problems and potential inconsistency with the cause. Conclusions. Quantum mechanics faces the measurement problem. Either one, the wave function is not complete, or second, there are no unique outcomes, or third, Schrödinger's equation is not correct. Negating one of these assumptions leads to, I just mentioned a few interpretations that we are going to discuss here more. Like the first assumption leads to the Bohmian mechanics. Second leads to many worlds, and the third leads to collapsed theories. Schrödinger's cat is an instance of the same general problem, not a quantum curiosity, which is often publicly presented. Connected with what Rory said about paradoxes. Certain paradoxes are just statements, kind of curious statements you would not have thought at first, but they actually occur. You can just convince yourself by logic that they do. Schrödinger's cat is not like that. Some people seem to, of course there's a lot of confusion, kind of funny, simply kind of entertainment about it. Some people maybe seem to believe still this is also one of the curious types, but it is not. It's a really an illustration of the problem. The problem postulated in the Copenhagen interpretation does not really solve the measurement problem, but rather leads to further problems and inconsistencies. And we saw also that numerous objections to the measurement problem do not apply. Perhaps you have a lot of further ones. So let's come to this discussion now. Thank you.
Also the, say, measurement apparatus and treat it quantum mechanically. But how do you can you talk about preparing a system if to be consistent you must consider yourself being part of the system?
Okay, but then just say like to prepare the system and the algorithms.
And the initial state.
I mean simply the initial state of that system is such as a SAN. Simply consider such a situation.
Yeah, but how can you like if from a physics point of view, like you want to do an experiment. And if you say it's not okay to take the measurement as something out of the Schrodinger formalism, why can you take preparing the system as out of the quantum mechanics?
Certainly people are going to talk about it and do that for certain systems. But simply consider, you could say, consider any initial wave function that just contains something about a point. It is not so important, as I said. I mean, it's simply a subjection. What if you didn't start from an initial product state? Either you start with something else, you still get this microscopic superposition in the end. I think this was just to make this kind of talk more easy, more precise. Yeah?
That's a follow-up question to what you were just saying. So are you basically saying we can just start in status quo no matter what the initial state is right now? We just start?
Yeah, I wanted to have just consider such a situation. It seems to be that in practice people can consider such situations. I mean, simply it corresponds to a situation someone prepares in this laboratory, but preparing is a certain talk, but it has a like atom and couples it to go device. At the beginning they are more or less independent and then sees what happens. Simply this situation what I have in mind and try to give a quantum mechanical model. Perhaps this model is a little bit simplified and one could make it more general, but even in these cases when you make it more general, then you would still get the same problem.
So, if I make my comment, I think you assume you can just have a simple situation, you start the example that the world, you, the system has all collapsed in some well-defined pure state, and you know that it's a pure state, and whatever collapse is, let's start our example in this particular state, everything is pure, everything has collapsed, and now even if I start here, then I would, if I do the measurement, I will need to see something like a microscopic superposition.
I think the objection here was to that, it was simply like, yeah, it collapsed with something, you could do this collapse by do a measurement before, and then kind of see, okay, then you get the same, when you do a measurement again, it's your experience, you get the same state, so you know you have to get that state. But that only works if you have a kind of measurement device for the thing that you're talking about. But now we were just modeling the measurement device also as quantum mechanical, then, I mean, by that logic, if you wanted to prepare in that way the state, you would need a further measurement device that prepares you that thing initially like that. So it's actually important, like, if you run into this kind of question that didn't matter so much, that you really like have this acceptance form of the initial thing. Yeah?
I think at one point you mentioned we will be able to model the whole universe with a wave function. And my question was, so in cosmology, like there are people who try to model universes using wave functions, but they have to satisfy the Wheeler-David equation,
mm-hmm.
in which basically you get the Hamiltonian is zero.
Yeah, it's for quantum gravity, right?
Yeah. And so my question is, like, doesn't that sort of, because in the concept of quantum mechanics that I have is that you have a wave function in Hilbert space that's that follows Schrodinger equation,
yeah.
The time-dependent Schrodinger equation. But, like, when you, that kind of takes that time dependence out of the wave function because you just have a zero Hamiltonian. So, I don't know how you could describe the whole, like, the condition of the universe.
Yeah, that is, of course, an interesting question. They are kind of more complicated responses to it. For example, in quantum mechanics, you could have the fact that the wave function of the universe is time independent, but the wave function of a subsystem is still time independent. So, it could be, I mean, that theory, simply that this is not a paradox for some of the situations. I mean, could rightly wonder, however, you get a time independence in there. No, that's right. Of course, the Wheeler-DeWittel equation would be just something for kind of pure gravity. So it would not be about measures. The theories I talked about here, as a universe, imagine a kind of non-relativistic universe just of a lot of particles. And so then the question, of course, doesn't really occur about the Wheeler-DeWittel equation. But still, if you have a Wheeler-DeWittel equation, you have to wonder about such things.
Can I also react to this question?
Just so you hear kind of another opinion on that. So you can ask the question, how do you get out the right results of the measurement? If you start from the Wheeler-DeWitt equation, or you can do it for some simplified model, just non-relativistic quantum mechanics, just ordinary Schrodinger equation, but you claim it's for all particles in the universe. Now, so Matthias was focusing in his talk on this simple case. If you just use non-relativistic Schrodinger equation, then you already run into trouble, the measurement problem. Now, if you want to use the Wheeler-DeWitt equation, you have further trouble with the time independence of the wave function. But at least you would imagine if you can make progress on the easy case, then maybe that also helps with the more difficult case of the Wheeler-DeWitt equation.
But like even in the easy case, how would you set boundaries to the wave function? Like the way I'm thinking is, essentially you have the integral of the wave function range from infinite past to infinite in the future. So if you model the universe that way, are you just basically saying something like that the universe is eternal? Like if the universe is just running on the Schrodinger equation, how do you choose the boundary conditions for the like even in the simplified case?
I guess you would have to make some simplified model, such as to assume that there is some initial time for the universe, you call that t equals zero, and see what happens from then onwards. Maybe if you consider instead what happened in the infinite past at t equals minus infinity, you get maybe some crazy conclusions, but what do you expect if it's only a simplified model?
There's a book on decoherence by Schlosshauer, if you know it, from 10 years ago. And he talks about the measurement problem as being actually three different problems.
Okay, which ones?
So one would be why we have a preferred basis in measurements, like often position basis. Another one is then like Schrodinger's cat, why we do not see interference microscopically, usually. And then the last one is how do we actually select a particular outcome out of the many? And when he wrote this book, he was of the opinion that the first two are pretty much solved by decoherence.
Really, like even the fact that you have a single definite outcome.
It is, so, and that's the one that is not.
Oh, okay, that's one.
Yeah. So he thought that was the one remaining, and he considered it just sort of being the main other interpretations. So depending on what the interpretation you like, you'll have one answer. So I just wonder if you had any comment on that, or if
you
were saying you're talking about different
I
kinds.
Think those are, this is a kind of more fine, it's kind of split up, and I think that I would also mostly agree with that. I mean, I haven't really thought about these fine splittings, but yeah, certainly even we get a definite outcome is the question.
Okay,
but
so
perhaps it's also like I mean, I wanted to put this more generally because I wanted to admit several different conclusions. Maybe this fine splitting will actually push you towards certain theories more than towards others. For example, the many roles in the patient would not actually select one outcome at all. So it would just say that every outcome occurs. So in some sense, it would not really fit in the scheme.
Mm-hmm.
So just a comment. The free measurements analysis about the free measurement problems actually by Tim was done by Tim Horn, the founder of this institute. So he wrote a paper in the 90s, I think, where he analyzed these three.
Okay, who did Schlosshauer?
Sorry?
Who did?
Tim Horn.
Ah,
so he's building probably on his text, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's exactly Tim Horn's analysis of these three aspects of it.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to add some remark. I often want to add here.
Yeah.
This article by Tim Maudlin, titled Three Measurement Problems, it's a very nice article that I recommend you to read.
Doesn't that make any consistent results in the qualities? Like, because in now, like Fogg does here, so it says you need to have unique outcomes, right? Like, can you, by, so basically, is minimum local? That's my question.
I think this is better posed, a question better posed to that. We will talk about the many walls interpretation. It's also like it depends a little bit on, yeah, okay, on your version of many walls, but you will answer that.
There is no action at a distance in many words, but there is no locality in many words.
I think many walls just gets balanced theorem also.
No.
No.
Okay.
I mean, certainly have the predictions for Bell's.
There's no problem, but the Bell's theory requires single outcome. Without single outcome, there's no any.
That was the point I was trying to make. Like, if you get rid of single outcomes, then the Bell's theorem is not like my rules.
No. Correct.
Okay.
So, if there are no further questions, then let's close this session. But before, let me say, we'll have lunch over at the terrace at the kitchen, and the next talk will be at 3 o'clock in the afternoon by Lev about many worlds. And now let's thank Matthias.